Australia and Canada hailed as the top go-to countries for Filipino students. The United Kingdom, New Zealand, and the U.S. and Ireland also making the list. That's according to global consulting firm International Education Specialist, or IDP Philippines, which helps students study abroad. It cites good opportunities in these countries, including a chance to work while studying and odds of permanent migration for the students' choice. The five countries collectively host around 53,000 Filipino students, and this number is expected to grow as much as 10% every year. IDP, however, warns aspiring students must prepare enough money as school fees in these countries can reach 2.5 million pesos per year, excluding cost of living expenses. U.S. President Joe Biden says discussions with his Chinese counterpart Xi Jinping made real progress. The two leaders met for the first time in a year at the sidelines of the APEC summit in San Francisco, with hopes of repairing a relationship that's been strained by economic competition and military and diplomatic missteps. Washington says Biden raised China's less welcoming business environment and then asked China to talk to Iran and raise issues in Ukraine and the Middle East. Discussions on maritime tensions in the South China Sea also on the agenda. The U.S. side saying Xi Jinping assured there are also no plans of invading Taiwan.
We have to ensure that competition does not veer into conflict. And we also have to manage it responsibly, that competition. That's what the United States wants and what we intend to do. I also believe it's a world wants for both of us. Candid exchange. We also have a responsibility to our people and the work in the world to work together when we see it in our interest to do so. And a critical global challenge that we face, from climate change to counter-narcotics to artificial intelligence, demand our joint efforts.
As for Xi, he says the relationship between the U.S. and China is the most important bilateral relations in the world.
China-U.S. relationship has never been smooth sailing over the past 50 years or more, and it always faces problems of one kind or another. Yet it has kept moving forward amid twists and turns. For two large countries like China and the United States, turning their back on each other is not an option. Planet Earth is big enough for the two countries to succeed, and one country's success is an opportunity for the other.
This is Xi's first visit to the U.S. in 6 years. I just wanted to update everyone here. The two leaders also have agreed on efforts to combat fentanyl, restore high-level military communications, and hold a dialogue about artificial intelligence during that four-hour summit that saw them, you know, seek, at least try to repair a bilateral relationship under intense strains. We are still waiting for President Joe Biden's news conference. Also, pro and anti-Chinese protesters are outside of the venue where President Xi Jinping is set to hold meetings with the business community. Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. all set for the APEC summit. Marcos will meet his Pacific Rim counterparts as well as various American companies and business leaders to seek more investment opportunities. Aside from his economic agenda, he also intends to discuss geopolitical issues with other countries.
Ito, marami po tayong mga kailangang pag-usapan sa ating mga kaibigan, hindi lamang dito sa Amerika, kundi sa iba't ibang bansa. At hindi lamang tungkol sa ekonomiya, hindi lang tungkol sa negosyo, hindi lang tungkol sa investment, kung hindi pati na sa mga nangyayari na tinatamaan din tayo, nararamdaman natin. May gera ngayon sa Ukraine, nagkagera na ngayon sa Israel. At ito po, meron tayong mga problema sa South China Sea. Ito po ay mahalaga na makausap natin lahat ng ating mga kasamahan, lahat ng mga ating kaalyado na bansa na tumutulong sa atin.
The president started his six-day visit to San Francisco by attending a gathering with the Filipino community there on Wednesday. He lauded their economic contributions to the country, with the U.S., home to some 4 million Filipinos, remaining the biggest single source of OFW remittances to the Philippines. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. enters into an agreement with leading Silicon Valley companies to collaborate on artificial intelligence and cybersecurity. Now, this deal was made during a roundtable meeting with tech firms and VCs in San Francisco, California. In attendance were C-level executives from VC firm Knight Dragon, Visa, Microsoft, Google company Mandiant, Singapore Investment Corporation or GIC, HP, MasterCard, and Plug and Play Ventures. Tech firms have expressed interest to bring their technologies, particularly generative AI, to the Philippines, which they say would be beneficial to the country considering its young and powerful workforce. Marcos has been looking for ways to beef up the country's cybersecurity after several government agencies fell victim to cyber attacks. The Philippine banking sector now understands more than ever the importance of digitizing to adapt to the changing needs of its consumers. This is according to Eugene Acevedo, President and CEO of the Rizal Banking Corporation, or RCBC, who says, without digital transformation, Philippine lenders are bound to fail.
Some banks have been doing is they've accepted the fact that if they don't change, they will perish. Because if you're a customer and somebody gives you a much better service, even among banks, you go to that other bank that gives you better service. There are ways to make things much easier for their customers. And that often means transferring bank services to a mobile app.
Right.
Because really, a branch costs between 10 to 12 million a year to run.
The World Bank has recently approved a $600 million loan to the Philippines to help its adoption of digital payments and financial services. Newly appointed Philippine Agriculture Chief Francisco Tiu Laurel Jr. wants to continue the plans of his predecessor, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Laurel made this remark as he defended his agency's proposed 2024 budget worth over 167 billion pesos before the Senate. He hopes to increase local production in the country to ease prices of agricultural commodities. He's also eyeing to reduce the role of middlemen in delivering products, which means having to deliver seeds and fertilizer on time, helping in irrigation, processing the produce, and maximizing yields.
Our plans for the Department of Agriculture is basically the marching orders of our president now, which is to increase production through use of rice and other products, through the use of technology, modernization, and improved logistics. No, to lower cost of all the products that we produce in this country. By increasing production, we will hopefully lessen importation through mechanization and modernization. We hope to achieve better yields, no, or recoveries, so that we have less waste.
Government assets may be sold to raise enough capital for the Maharlika Investment Fund. Rafael Consing Jr., the newly appointed CEO of the Maharlika Investment Corporation, admits the current seed money, which amounts to less than 100 billion pesos, will not be enough to fund big-ticket infrastructure projects as the law intends. Consing also wants to hold an investor roadshow to raise more funds. He says a minimum 10% return on investment is feasible for the fund. Four industries being eyed for initial investments, these are agriculture, energy, information and communications, as well as tourism, with priority given to some of the 197 flagship infrastructure projects approved by the National Economic and Development Authority Board. Consing notes he's particularly interested in airport projects.
It's for us to be able to identify which other assets that they can contribute to the fund. Because if you look at, for example, the way they've done it in Indonesia, which is probably the most, the most proper comparable, Indonesia, they put in both cash and assets. So that's exactly what we're going to be doing.
Meanwhile, Consing denies the implementing rules and regulations of the Maharlika Law were relaxed to accommodate his appointment.
By putting in those qualifications, it had the effect of amending the law. which is not the intention. So what they did was they simply brought it back and aligned it with what the law exactly said. And that was not just applicable to the PCEO. It was similarly applicable to all members of the board, be it regular or independent.